Good evening, everybody. Welcome to First Wednesday. Why don't you stand together? Would you join me as we call out to the Lord tonight? Lord, we welcome you into this place. We set aside this time for you tonight. We come to open our hearts, to open our ears. We come to seek your face and to ask your presence to come and be with us tonight. We humble ourselves before you. We worship you. We bring a grateful heart, for you are our Savior and our Redeemer. Would you quiet the distractions of the week and the world? And I pray that you would help us hear and sense your presence and your voice in this place tonight. So we welcome you here. We welcome you, Lord. In the name that is above every name, Jesus Christ, we pray and we sing and worship, lift our hands, lift our voices, and we look to your word. And all God's people said, amen. Amen. Let's seek after him, church.
There's nothing worth more that could ever come close. Nothing can compare.
Your glory, God. God. Meet us in this place, oh mighty, mighty warrior, our Savior, our King. You are good. You are great. We lift you high tonight. Come on, church. Let's come on.
Beginning for something brand new here at Prestonwood. That is our first Wednesday. I am so glad that you came. And let me give you a heads up as what will happen during our first Wednesday services, the first Wednesday of every month. First of all, we're all going to be together just like we are right now from Saturday night, Sunday morning, both services. Our North Campus is meeting at this same time at our North Campus, but we've got our great Prestonwood Choir and Orchestra in the house tonight. Great to have everybody in. And we've got our student ministry here tonight. Students, would you hold on? Give me a fist pump. Can I see all the students right over here? And all of you who have come this evening, and those of you who are with us online, one thing we want to do is to seek the God of heaven. That is first and foremost, to come here together as believers, as this body. Everyone is welcome. We welcome anyone and everyone to come. But this service is a service that is designed for God's church, God's people, because we need God. We need revival. Our nation desperately needs the Lord. And so we're going to get together each month like this. As in the book of Acts chapter 2, it says they were all together in one place. And what were they doing? They were praying and praising God. And that's when the Spirit of God came upon them. And they united and ignited and spread the word of Christ throughout Jerusalem. And thousands upon thousands of people came to Christ. That's our prayer, that we would unite as a church and ignite as God's people, and then spread to this community with fires of evangelism and around the world in Jesus' name. So we're going to worship. We're going to hear some great testimonies each time. We're going to hear, there will be times of prayer, not tonight, but going forward, we will have communion together. We'll share the Lord's Supper together. And that way you can count on that every month, that we will be together around the Lord's table. And then we're going to preach. Sometimes I'll do it. Sometimes Jarrett will do it, Neil, but we'll have guest preachers. I'm going to invite some of the greatest preachers in the world to come here on Wednesday night and deliver the Word of God to us. So you can count on that. And it's going to be fantastic. So I want to ask you just to take a seat right now. And as you may know, I hope you know, this is the 25th year of our Prestonwood Pregnancy Center. And the other day I was with our team and just had an incredible time. Leanne Jameson is leading the way right there. Welcome our key staff of the Prestonwood Pregnancy Center. Of course, there are many volunteers. And Leanne, what I'd like for you to do, this is Leanne right here, and what I would like Leanne to do is quickly introduce everyone and maybe give us an idea of what each person is doing, because many people here, you may not know exactly what we do at the Pregnancy Center and what these people are called and committed to doing. So Leanne, remind us as to what you all are doing and our volunteers with you every week. In the name of the Lord. This is Leanne.
Thank you, Pastor. Well, let me introduce down the line. This is Whitney, and she is one of our nurse sonographers. Yesenia handles our client services. Kat handles client services, and that they also manage all of our client advocates, our volunteers. We have Tamika handles donor development. Laura is one of our RDMSs. She's a sonographer. And Betty Goff, she's also in development.
Great. And so the Pregnancy Center, just give us the basics, where we are located, including the mobile unit, and just tell everybody what you are doing and how we can pray for you.
Oh, that's, well, we are located at the entrance of UTD, a very key position for us, on the corner of Campbell and Floyd. And we also have two mobile units, soon to have a third mobile unit. Yeah. So how can you pray? Well, first off, you can pray for us every single day. We see young women and men who come to us at probably one of the lowest points in their life in an unplanned pregnancy. And so we step in to offer them hope and love and truth in a very safe environment. And so that's to pray for us, because this year we're so excited. We have seen a 50% increase in the number of clients walking through our door. That's a huge increase, but even more exciting, yes. Even more exciting is the fact that we are at a 98% increase in salvations. We are just over, yes. Awesome. But here's the statistic I'm most excited about, and that is that we have seen an over 200% increase in changed views. Those are people coming to us saying that they want an abortion and leaving saying that they choose life. And that's a miracle.
So maybe maybe give us some stories about those statistics. I know you've got some.
Oh, I've got stories.
All right. Tell us recently what happened.
Okay, well, you know, a lot of people ask, why the increase? Well, obviously, one, as Pastor always says, this is a Jesus ministry. He loves life, and that is evident every day in our center. We also have a new prayer app, Friends of PPC, so when an abortion-minded woman comes on site, we push that out and all of you pray, so if you haven't downloaded that. But also, probably one of the other reasons I'd love to share is we have a new 3D, 4D machine. There's a couple of pictures from it that tells you just...
Could I just say, I have to interrupt right here.
Okay.
That is a 3D shot of our little granddaughter on the way with Kelly and Jason Flores right there. That is Lauren Olivia right there, alive and well and on her way.
Isn't that incredible? Well, you can see how seeing that image for a young couple thinking that this isn't a life, how that is life-changing. In fact, let me just share a story and then I'll let Whitney share a story. Just a couple of weeks ago, we had a young couple come into the center. Both of them were very determined that they wanted to have an abortion. And so much so that the young man, we try to get both of the couple, or whoever the young woman brings as a support system, we want her in that sonogram room as well for that very reason, to see that image. And so, but this, they were so determined that they were going to have an abortion that she didn't even want the father of the baby in there. So we began to do the scan. And that baby, there was a heartbeat. We could hear the heartbeat, but that baby was laying perfectly still. There wasn't just no movement whatsoever. Well, she began to look at that screen and she's starting to hear that heartbeat. And she looks at the sonographer and she says, you know what? I want the father of the baby to come in here, please. So we went out to the waiting room and we called him back and he came in. And as soon as he walked into that room, he started to speak to the young mother, and that baby started to dance in that womb.
Amen.
Every time he stopped speaking, that baby laid perfectly still. And every time that young baby heard his or her daddy's voice, it just started to move. Well, at that moment, both of them, they were startled. They couldn't help but be. And just in that very moment, life was chosen.
Amen. Amen.
Whitney?
Well, I say that I have one of the best jobs at the center because I get to do that every day. I get to see these clients that come in and they say, I don't think I can do this. And we said, well, let us just show you your baby. And so about a month ago, we had a client come in and she was very quiet, very timid. And she was just, you could tell she kind of wanted to keep her baby, but her parents wanted her to have an abortion. Her mother was making her an appointment at an abortion clinic. She said, you cannot have this baby. And so when she first came for the first appointment, she had a pregnancy test, but she was a little too early for us to do a sonogram. So she came, set an appointment to come back the next week. We prayed and prayed for this girl to come back, because sometimes we have those abortion-minded clients that set an appointment and we never see them again. And we try to call them and sometimes they don't answer. And so we just have to trust that they made a choice for a life. Well, so that morning, our shift leader said, can we just pray for this girl? We start every shift with prayer. And so we prayed for her to come. And about 15 minutes before her appointment, her aunt came. And we said, well, she's not here yet. And so she said, well, I'll wait. The girl came with the father of the baby and her mother, the one that wanted her to have an abortion. So we brought them back to the sonogram room, and she was still very early, very early. And so we were not sure that we would see what we wanted to see at that point. And the moment the probe went on her belly, there was the baby, right as the sunshine with a heart just flickering away. And usually you can look at their face and tell, okay, I know what they're thinking. This is amazing. The room was really quiet, except for the aunt who said, you know, a baby is never a bad thing. And so when the scan was over, I said, we usually ask our clients, the abortion-minded clients, would you like a photo? Most of the time they say no, they don't want one. And so we kind of save one just in case. And they said, yes, we'd like five. And I was kind of shocked and I thought, huh, okay, not what I was thinking. And then I asked everyone to step out of the room so that I could talk one-on-one with her. And I said, so can you tell me a little bit about what's going on? What's going on? What have you made a decision about what you want to do? And she said, I'm keeping my baby. Amen. My mom and dad have come around and I'm keeping my baby and I'm gonna parent. And that moment, you just can't, yeah, it's priceless.
Well, amen. And stories like these are repeated again and again and again. This is spiritual warfare, people, and we engage spiritual forces that work against life. Satan comes to kill, steal, and destroy, but Jesus said, I've come that you might have life and have it more abundantly. And so here at Prestonwood, we happily stand united and ignited for life, life in Jesus, and life of the unborn. It was interesting, more than interesting, it was intriguing. Last night I was watching the debate, the vice presidential debate, and to hear Mike Pence so beautifully and boldly share his personal faith in Jesus Christ and his commitment to life, life in the womb, and saving life and the sanctity of life, it was thrilling. But we know ultimately that this is a mission of God's people and God's church to save lives and to save life. We pray for laws. We pray for changes in our laws. But until that happens, we're going to be out there every single day with our mobile units and at our location. And we're going to be fighting the good fight of faith. And we're going to be winning. We're going to be winning, right? Because every life is a life that God loves. Scott Turner, state representative, is here tonight. Of course, Scott is a faithful member of Prestonwood. I've known him for about 25 years, more than that. I want Scott to come, and now we're all going to pray, but I want Scott to take a microphone. Just take that one right there, Scott. And I want you to express our heart in prayer and pray specifically for our pregnancy center and this ministry. Would you do that?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Father, we thank you, Lord Jesus, for the Prestonwood Pregnancy Center. We thank you, Lord, that you are a God of life. We thank you, Jesus, that you are the giver of life. You love life. Father, I pray a hedge of protection upon this wonderful ministry. God, upon Ms. Jameson and her staff, Father God, the staff of the Pregnancy Center. And Lord, we pray, Father, that every day that when clients come in, the Lord Jesus, they would sense your presence. That Holy Spirit of God, that you would have their way. They may come in thinking one thing, but Father, we pray that they would leave thinking that this is life and I want life, I want my child, I want my baby. Father, we thank you for the work that has been done so far. And God, we thank you for the work that you will do. God, we bind the schemes of the enemy. No weapon formed against the pregnancy center shall prosper. Father, I do pray, Lord Jesus, for these young men and young women. First, God, I pray that they will make wise, godly decisions. Father, even in the midnight hour, Father, in the throes of decision making, Father, I pray they will say yes to Jesus and no to the world, no to the devil, no to the flesh. But Father, in those moments, Father God, would they become pregnant? Father, they say it's unwanted. Well, Father, every pregnancy is precious to you, Jesus. And Father, I pray you would change perspectives, change heart and minds, Father God, of these young women, their parents, their friends. Father, thank you for our church standing for life.
And God, I pray that we would all support the pregnancy center, Father, with our prayers, with our finances, with our energy, Father, with our efforts, Lord Jesus, that it would be a thriving ministry, Father God, not just by name, but Father, by deed, by word, Father. Help them as they're on the campus of UTD, Father. I pray that we'll shine in light in the midst of darkness. Father, keep them safe, keep them strong, give them wisdom in this hour, Father. Give them clarity and understanding. And Lord Jesus, as a Christian body, as a church body, we say yes to life. Yes to life, Father, not only outside of the womb, but in the womb, for we believe life begins at conception. Matters not what politics says, matters not, Father God, what people say or the media say. You, Jesus, say life begins at conception. You say you know the plans for us. You say you formed us in the womb. You knew us before we ever came to be. Every day of our life is written in your book before everyone came to be. God, we believe your word. We stand on it. We thank you, Jesus, for this great ministry. Be glorified in it, Father. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you.
Let's give these great folks a hand. And if you are a volunteer or a prayer partner at the Pregnancy Center, would you hold up your hand? Our volunteers present here tonight, thank you for coming. Thank you for serving every single day and overcoming evil with good. Well, I think we ought to sing something after that. So Michael and team, come on back up here and let's sing together and worship together. Just remain standing.
Through the storm, he is Lord. him be found, dressed in his righteousness alone.
Would you be seated, and back to back, Jarrett Stevens and then Sean Callender are going to come and give us a word of exhortation and challenge as we pray. We've prayed for ministry, we've prayed for unity already, but we want to pray for vitality, for spiritual power and revival, and we want to pray for purity in our lives and in our church. And so Jarrett and Sean, come and speak to us. Call us to prayer, call us to God this evening for revival and restoration of our own lives.
It is a privilege to urge us on to revival and to call us to call on God and cry out to God for a fresh wind of His Spirit. Earlier this week, Monday and Tuesday, Pastor and I were at Midwestern Seminary. He was preaching in chapel, and I was just traveling along with him, carrying his Bible. It was good. Had a good trip. And Midwestern Seminary has a great museum up there called the Spurgeon Library. And many of you don't know, maybe you've never heard of Charles Spurgeon, but he's a big deal to us preachers. He was known as the Prince of Preachers. Here's a picture of him. Now listen to this, students. At the age of 15, that's when he was saved. At the age of 16, he preached his first sermon. At the age of 22, he was pastoring the largest church in the London area. When he died at 57, he was the world's most popular preacher. He preached over 3,600 sermons, written over 49 commentaries, volumes regarding theology and the Bible. He was an unbelievable preacher. And he wrote a lot about revival and the Spirit-filled life. And I just want to read you this quote. It says this, that without the Spirit of God, we can do nothing. We are as ships without wind or chariots without steeds, like branches without sap. We are withered like coals without fire. We are useless. I just thought about that quote. We are useless without the Spirit of God moving in us. And so I want Neil Jeffrey to come up here. He's going to lead us in a time of corporate prayer. And we're going to ask the Spirit of God to light a fire in our own hearts, in the hearts of our families, in the hearts of our church. But here's what we've got to have. We've got to have humility. There's got to be a sense of brokenness that says, God, we can't do this on our own. We need you. There's got to be a sense of desperation, that we're tired of going through the motions, that we're tired of just doing the same old thing over and over and over again. God, we need you. Let your Spirit fall on me, on this place, in our church tonight. And then we've got to pray with a sense of urgency. And so Neil's going to lead us in this time of corporate prayer, praying for revival and for a fresh wind of the Spirit of God upon our lives and in our church.
We're going to pray. I'm going to pray, but I want you to just bow your heads and kind of get in a posture of prayer right where you are. And if you got a loved one beside you, I would love it if you would take their hand, or, and just as we enter this time of prayer of asking God to revive us again, to send a revival. Lord Jesus, we need a revival. Truth be known, in our own hearts, I need a revival. Lord, if we're honest with ourselves, we desperately need a touch of Jesus, of the Spirit of God in us. The Bible says that the Lord's hand is not so short it cannot save, neither is his ear so dull that he cannot hear. But our iniquities have made a separation between us and our God. Our sins have hidden his face so that he does not hear. The Bible also says that if God's people, us, those who believe, who are called by his name, humble themselves and pray and seek his face and turn from our wicked ways, then the Bible says God will hear. And he will forgive our sin and heal our land. Lord, we pray for revival. We need a revival. We're sinners. We need a Savior. And praise God, there is a Savior, there's a Redeemer, and his name is Jesus. And he has come to save his people from their sins. And Lord, we pray for revival in our own lives. I pray if there's a person in this room this evening who's never trusted Christ, that the Spirit of God would just right now communicate his love, his forgiveness, his righteousness, his desire to do a work in that a person's life, and that person might be saved. Lord, I pray that the Spirit of salvation would be all over this church and every service and every ministry and all that we do, that Jesus Christ as the Savior would come through everything we do and people would be saved. And there'd be a spirit of people being drawn to Jesus Christ to be saved here in places like this, all over this city, all over this state, in this nation and around this world. Lord, we need a revival in our own lives. Lord, I want to love you more. Lord, I'm a Christian. I'm saved. I'm a believer. But God, the fact is, we all know that sin gets in the way and life just kind of gets busy in so many things and our hearts are so prone to wander. Lord, we want you to revive us again and to help us to fall in love all over again with Jesus Christ for who he is and what he's done. And Lord, may we be so in love with you and so filled with the Spirit of God that what comes out of us and what we say and what we do, and if times are hard and there's a storm and we get squeezed, what comes out is Jesus. Lord, I pray for our church. We have a wonderful church. This is a wonderful place, but God, we want you to purify us as a church and just do a new work here, that what comes out of this place and everything we do is Jesus. And that he'd be lifted up and he'd be magnified and he'd be glorified. And as the Bible says, as he is lifted up, you would draw all unto you and many would be saved. Lord, we pray for our nation. Lord, our nation needs revival. Our nation needs an answer. Our nation needs hope. Our nation needs life. Our nation needs truth. All of that is found in Jesus. Lord, our world is so mixed up. Our world is so against you. Our world is so bizarre in so many ways, and so many things are happening that are above us, beyond us, and yet nothing is above you. Nothing is beyond you. Everything is under your authority, your plan, and your purpose. And our desire is that your will would be done on earth as it is in heaven. You would accomplish your will here, and that there would be a revival in our land, a turning back to you, that Jesus Christ would be seen clearly and powerfully for who he is, as the King of Kings and Lord of Lords and the crucified Savior and the one day coming King, and that you would draw all to you. God, there's been revivals in the past, in other places, in other times in history. There's revivals happening now in different parts of the world. Lord, we pray for revival here in our midst, in our nation, in our world, at the kingdom of God, that his will would be done on earth as it is in heaven. Lord, in Jesus' name, revive us again. We pray. Amen.
Recently, our church launched an emphasis on purity. And just not long ago, I returned from a mission trip. And on that mission trip, one of the things that we were concerned about daily was the water. We were thinking we wanted to make sure that we had purified water that we were putting into our bodies every single day. And you know, as the church of the Lord Jesus Christ, as believers, it's important that we pursue a life of holiness and purity, that we don't allow anything into our lives that would corrupt the temple of the Lord Jesus Christ. In fact, our student ministry is being attacked on a daily basis when it comes to this issue of living a life free from sexual temptation. And so I want to invite Clint Ivey, he's our student ministry pastor, to come up and lead us in a time of prayer for our students, because today, 70% of teenagers are seeing sexually explicit material online at least once a month, if not higher than that. And so our teenagers are in this fight. Not only our teenagers, but the entire culture that we're in is fighting this issue of sexual temptation. So Clint, come and lead us in prayer for our student ministry, if you would.
Well, I believe that there is big power in prayer. We go to a God who is able to move. And so right now, just as a body, we want to pray for our student ministry. So students, if you would stand, we as a church would love just to pray for you and ask God to move in your hearts in a real way. Father, we come to you in the name of your Son, Jesus. God, you are who you say you are, the King of heaven. And God, as a church, we want to intercede on behalf of our students. God, we know that the leaders of the church are sitting in that group, that the men and women who will make the decisions about our country and our future are right here. And God, we pray that you would protect them in a very real way from our world. God, as many of them have pledged their allegiance to you, they have died to themselves and they have made themselves through your Spirit alive in Christ. God, I pray that you would just give them victory over the things that are thrown at them. God, that you would encourage them to be faithful. God, you would grant them great community and accountability around them. God, that we would see a generation rise up that loves you with complete abandon, that holds to purity and faithfulness and obedience. And God, you would use them to change the world forever. I'm so thankful for the students that are coming up, the students that will be taking over. God, that you would use them in powerful ways. So Lord, I thank you, I love you, and I lift these students up to you in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen.
As we launch this emphasis on purity, we've launched it through our children's ministry, our student ministry, and our adult ministry. And we want to invite all of our children's ministry, our student ministry, and our adult Bible fellowship leaders and teachers to come here and to just take a knee here at this altar. So if you're involved in any aspect of leadership on a leadership team in our adult Bible fellowship classes, our children's ministry, or our student ministry, would you come right now? And we want to have a time of prayer as we seek the face of God and we seek to live a life of purity. The psalmist says in Psalm 24, he says, "Who may ascend your holy hill? He who has clean hands and a pure heart." And our desire is that we communicate this throughout our church in such a way that we would see young men and young women and adults begin living a life of purity. And if there's an area in their particular life right now that they're not living for Christ, that they would confess that they would go to somebody, and that they would begin living a life of righteousness for the Lord Jesus Christ. So let's pray together now. Lord Jesus, we thank you, Father, that your love is so powerful and your grace is sufficient, God, to meet us where we're at. And God, it doesn't matter how far we've gone or the things that we've done, Lord, that your arms are big enough to scoop us up and to love us and to encourage us. And Father, Lord, as we communicate this topic of purity, living a life of purity before you, God, throughout our entire church, through our children's ministry, our student ministry, our adult area, Father, we pray, Lord, that we'd be able to communicate it in such a way, Lord, that it would be about grace and love and forgiveness. And God, that you would use each person in leadership from our children, students, adults, all throughout this church, Lord, God, that we would begin seeing something remarkable take place, God. You've called us, Lord, to be holy, for you are holy, God, and that is our desire, Lord, as leaders in the church, Lord. Let it begin in our hearts, Lord Jesus. Let it begin in our hearts. Let us begin modeling it. Let us be the ones, Lord, to show the world that the church of the Lord Jesus Christ is different, God, and that you've called us to be set apart from this world, to be aliens and strangers. Lord, we love you this evening, God. We thank you, Lord, for each one of these leaders here tonight, God. Lord, may you use their gifts, talents, and abilities, Lord, to further your work and your kingdom. And we pray all these things in the powerful name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Are you getting into this, church? Are we together? Are we praying together? And one of the reasons I want us to gather like this is because we do get to hear from some of our ministers and ministries that you might not ordinarily hear from. And so each Wednesday when we're together, we'll have an opportunity to hear from these great people who serve us. And I want to thank Sean. Sean heads family ministries here at Prestonwood. And he is responsible for counseling and guiding and planning events and opportunities for families to grow, for marriages to grow. And we've given him this huge assignment of our purity campaign, and he's doing a fantastic job. Jeff Young is, of course, one of our most important leaders here at Prestonwood. He leads spiritual development and formation, our Bible teaching ministry, and a great staff that our small group ministry is founded around God's Word through the teaching and the fellowship with God's people. And our Bible fellowship ministry is also charged with the responsibility of reaching our neighbors and the nations with the gospel of Christ, starting right here, right now, and around the world. So I've asked Jeff to come and just give us a challenge regarding the opportunity that is all around us, and that we would pray for our neighbors and pray for the nations and pray for people who need Jesus. This is Jeff Young.
Thanks, Pastor. We're in the first year of a seven-year window where somewhere between 18,000 and 20,000 people will be relocating to within 5 miles of our church. You can see some of the companies on the screen behind me, but literally from coast to coast, people are moving to within 5 miles of our church, from the Northeast with companies like J.P. Morgan Chase and with Liberty Mutual, all the way across the country to California with Toyota, and everywhere in between, and literally all around the world, people are moving to your neighborhood, to my neighborhood, and to new neighborhoods that are popping up like crazy. 18,000 to 20,000 jobs, many more people than that. We begin to pray, and we begin to plan and figure out what can we do on the front end to be ready to embrace these people. And over the past year, several groups in our church began to knock on doors. We've knocked on over 2,000 new homes, introducing ourselves to these people, inviting them to block parties, inviting them to church, winning the right to share the gospel with them. And I just want to tell you about one lady. Her name's Valerie. Valerie came to one of our block parties in May. She met Chrissy Dunham and some other ladies from our church, and they built a relationship with her, invited her to come to church. And right here in this room this summer, she accepted Christ as her personal Lord and Savior. And just a few weeks ago, she was baptized right behind me. And yeah, go ahead. Just a few weeks ago, she was baptized, and now she's connected with a Bible fellowship. And, you know, Jesus' words could not be more current. Lift up your eyes and see. The fields are white unto harvest. They're white with a lot of construction dust, but they're also white, white hot with opportunities to reach people with the good news of Jesus Christ. And folks, you know that that's our mission. We exist to see as many people as possible reach for Jesus Christ. That's our goal. That's our mission. That's our passion. That's what gets us up in the morning, is partnering with Jesus and watching him change lives. God is still changing lives. I want you to bow your head, and I want you to ask God to think about someone that he's laid on your life, someone he's laid on your heart, someone that he's given you the opportunity to influence and impact for the gospel. You know, maybe students, it's somebody that's in a classroom, somebody that's new at school. Maybe it's someone that you know at the office. Maybe it's somebody at the health club. Maybe it's a new neighbor right down the street that you see walking their dog. And for some reason, God's pricked your heart about this particular couple, this particular person. And right now, you know that you know that you know that that's the person God wants you to pray and ask him to give you the opportunity to share your hope in Jesus Christ with them. Let's pray. Loving Heavenly Father, we are grateful for your Son Jesus and the fact that he has changed us, that he has saved us, that he's given us a hope, he's given us a future. We thank you that there's nothing more that we can do to earn more of that love. There's nothing that we have done that could cause you to love us less. We are recipients of your amazing grace, and we are so grateful. Father, also in your providence, you've let us be a part of this church, a church that unapologetically exists to reach people with the good news of Jesus Christ. And you have blessed this church year after year after year, not only with keeping the main thing, but letting us just rejoice and change life after change life. Again, Father, you are good. Father, you know that our mission statement is pulled right out of your word and that we exist to glorify you by sharing Christ and watching as many people as is possible come to faith in your Son, Jesus. Your word says that you are not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. Your word says that you have loved us with an everlasting love and you've called us to be a part of your family in moving forward the gospel mission. Your word says that there's no other name under heaven given to men by which we must be saved in the name of your Son, Jesus. Your word says that we are ambassadors. We are your representatives called to be about reconciling people to yourself. And so, Father, I pray that you would make us more aware of that calling. I pray that you would remind us of that calling, that we are to be your ambassadors, that we are to be reconcilers, that we are to be your representatives wherever we are, in the classroom, on the athletic field, in the office, at the coffee shop, at the club. God, we acknowledge that at times we are self-absorbed. We acknowledge that at times we crater and don't embrace the window of opportunity that you bring us. Father, we ask tonight that you would remind us that you have not given us a spirit of fear, but of power and of love and a sound mind. Remind us, Father, that you will always be with us. You will never forsake us. Remind us that you were at your very, very best when you sent Jesus to die for us, and without a person placing their faith and their hope in him, there is no remission of sin. Father, we want to be a church that is continued to flourish under the hand of your blessing, under the hand of your favor. And so, God, soften our hearts, grow our hearts for those who don't know you. Give us a more passionate, courageous heart. Father, give us the compassion of Andrew, who brought his friend to Jesus, his brother to Jesus. Give us a more passionate heart like Paul, who was willing to take a risk so that one more person could come to faith in your Son. Father, give us spiritual eyes into people's eternity. Help us to be mindful of moments, mindful of little interactions, to leverage those opportunities to bring and include and to just demonstrate that we care. Father, we also are grateful and we ask for your protection over our Prestonwood Network church planters in North America. We ask for your protection and for you to continue to use our global missionary partners all around the world. Would you give them the desires of their heart as it relates to their ministry, to their calling? Would you continue to use them to push back the darkness and to grow their church? Would you be sweet to meet them in times of refreshing in your word? Father, use our ministry partners just as you would use us to reach people with the hope of the gospel. It's in your Son Jesus' name that I pray. And everyone said, amen.
I want you to take God's word and turn with me to the book of Judges. Book of Judges, chapter 6. We're going to look for about 15 minutes at this fantastic passage of Scripture because it concerns how we win spiritual battles. Folks, we are in a battle. Our nation is in this battle, and we as the people of God certainly are a part of this battle. Now, Israel had forgotten God. It was a never-ending cycle of coming back to faith, revival would come, and then rebellion would follow, and retribution would come, captivity or bondage of some kind, judgment, and then renewal would come again. It was a never-ending cycle, it seems, when you read your New Testament. Well, we have one of those down periods, one of those defeated periods here in Judges chapter 6, when the people are crying out to God. They're living in fear and in failure. And they'd given up. They'd given up hope that things could ever change. The parallel is clear. Here in America, as secularism and satanic powers are on the move, relativism, which is the idea that there is no right and wrong, no solid, rock-solid authority in our lives, is similar to what is described in the book of Judges, chapter 17, verse 6, when it says that everyone did what was right in his own eyes. Does that sound familiar? Everyone was doing what was right in their own eyes. And so this battle that was raging in Israel in this day is raging in America today. It's a battle for the soul of our country, a battle between heaven and hell, light and darkness, evil and righteousness. But there's good news. As in the case of Israel, and we pray for America, God gives us another chance. And God gave Israel a plan to move out of their defeat and destruction and find victory. And I want to show you from this passage of Scripture, and we only have a few moments, so you're going to have to listen very quickly. But I want to show you from this passage some principles of victory in your life and in the life of God's people. And the first of these principles is what I'm going to call the principle of God's call. The principle of God's call. Look in chapter 6, beginning at verse 11. Now the angel of the Lord came and sat under the terebinth at Ophrah, which belonged to Joash the Abzarite, while his son Gideon, here's the key character, Gideon was beating out wheat in the winepress to hide it from the Midianites. And the angel of the Lord appeared to him and said to him, "The Lord is with you, O mighty man of valor." Now, at this point of his life, Gideon must have looked around over his shoulder and said, "Who, me?" Because Gideon was not a general at this point. As a matter of fact, he was eking out a living in a wine press. He was beating barley, and he was living in defeat. He was hiding out like the rest of Israel. They were overcome with an enemy by the name of the Midianites. And yet, God had a plan and a purpose for Gideon and the nation. And so an angel came. I know a little bit about angels these days. And here's one of those angel appearances in the Bible. An angel came and gave Gideon a call from God, a commission from God. Look at verses 21 through 24. 21 to 24. Then the angel of the Lord reached out of the tip of the staff that was in his hand and touched the meat and the unleavened cakes, and fire sprang from the rock and consumed the meat and unleavened cakes, and the angel of the Lord vanished from his sight. Then Gideon perceived that he was the angel of the Lord, and Gideon said, "Alas, O Lord God, for now I have seen the angel of the Lord face to face." Theology lesson real quickly. When you see the angel of the Lord mentioned in the Old Testament, that's a pre-incarnate appearance of Jesus. In other words, this is Jesus. This is the Lord. This is not one of the angels that God created, but this is the Creator himself. The Lord who is here manifesting himself, the angel of the Lord. And so Gideon now sees him face to face. But the Lord said to him, "Peace be to you. Do not fear. You shall not die." And then Gideon built an altar there to the Lord and called it, "The Lord is peace. The Lord is peace." The first thing that has to happen in our lives and in our nation is a renewed vision of who God is. That He is Lord. That He is the Almighty. What America needs is an alliance with the Almighty. We need a league with the Lord. We need to see God, who is the Lord, our peace. There will never be peace in our homes, our families, our streets, the division of this nation. There will never be peace. There will never be peace in the world until once again we see our God, who is the Lord of peace. We need an encounter with Him. You say, "Well, I would believe in God. I'd have a wake-up experience if I'd ever seen an angel like this. You know, if God showed up like an angel in my life, well, I guarantee you I would be different." Well, you have something better than an angel appearance. You have the Word of God. You have the Spirit of God living in you. And God is calling us to see God. Young people, I'm excited about so many of you who are hearing the call of God to do missions, to do ministry, to serve Christ in a unique way. But before you hear the call to go do something, you need to have a great vision of God. Then there's the principle of courage, what I'm going to call courage. Move over in chapter 6 again, or rather chapter 7. And verse 1. Then Zerubbabel, that is Gideon, and all the people who were with him rose early and encamped beside the spring of Herod. Hearing the call of God, Gideon was gathering an army, and he was so proud of his army. He had an army of 33,000, 32,000. He said, "Look at my army. We're going to go take down these Midianites." And yet God said to him something very strange. "Gideon, you've got too many. Too many, Lord. These Amalekites, or Midianites rather, they're like grasshoppers. They're everywhere. We've got 32,000 and that's good, but it's not enough. And you're telling me we've got too many?" God said, "Yes." And God said, "You tell all of the men who are afraid to go home. If they're afraid, tell them to go home." I presume Gideon thought a few hundred might leave, but it was a stampede. 22,000 left. What was God doing here? God was separating the men from the boys. Those who were afraid and those who were fearful and those who were ready to fight. You know why God had to take the cowards out? Because cowardice and fear is contagious. Contagious. Just as in the case when the Israelites were coming up on the land of promise and they were ready to take it, they sent those 12 spies, remember this? Sent 12 spies into the land to go check it out and to spy out the land so that they could take it. And 10 of those 12 came back and said, "It's too much. There are giants over there. We're afraid. We are like grasshoppers in their sight. Two men, Joshua and Caleb, said, no, yes, there are mighty enemies there, but in God's name, we can go and we can take it. And the people had a vote, and they said, we're not going. We're going to accept the majority report. You know, the majority report is not always right. And as a result, because they did not obey God and fear overcame the camp, they spent the next generation wandering around in the wilderness. Fear is contagious. I am so grateful for the courageous faith of Prestonwood Church. Through the years, we've taken some bold steps of faith that seemed risky at the time. And were there fears? Yes. Were there giants to overcome? No question about that. But in Jesus' name, we had a band of brothers and sisters who were courageous. You know why? Because God has not given us a spirit of fear. And if God be for us, who can be against us? And we need this principle of courage in our lives. I can do whatever God has called me to do. Then there was the principle of commitment. God looked at Gideon, and you can read about this when you get home tonight, and he said, you've still got too many. What? 22,000 left, they're down to 10,000. He said, yes, take them down to the brook Herod there and give them a test. I've been to this very spot. When we take our trips to Israel, we take our group to Herod Springs. And the very site, we know it's one of those sites that is dead center in Scripture, and we know exactly where we are. Gideon Spring is right there. We get down there and take this test together. Because God said, tell the men to go forward, and those who stick their mullet right in the water and lap like a dog, they're not on guard, they're not looking around, they're not cautious, careful, they're careless. Those who just stick their face in the water and start lapping, send all of them home. But those who kneel down like this and take the water and they're on guard, they're constantly watching, that's going to be your army. Guess how many were left? 300. Interesting, isn't it? That God is often testing us when we don't know it. These guys didn't know God was testing them. They didn't know that this was a test. It was a pop quiz. And they were careless and casual about their responsibility, and God said, we can't use you, send them home. And so now he's got 300. A magnificent minority. That's the test of commitment. The test of commitment. God is calling us to be courageous and committed. This is not a time for carelessness. Why? Because Peter tells us that Satan, like a roaring lion, is roaming about seeking whom he may devour. And if you're not ready, if you're not engaged in the spiritual battle, you'll be lunch or dinner. And so people that win spiritual battles are people that have a call. They see God, the greatness of God. They are courageous and bold in the fight. And they are committed to what God has called them to do. And then there's one final thing, what I'm going to call the principle of conquest. And what is that principle? Well, look at Judges chapter 6 and verse 34. Here's the secret to victory in your life and mine. But the Spirit of the Lord clothed Gideon. The Spirit of the Lord, what a picture. The Spirit of the Lord wore Gideon like a suit. In other words, this is a picture of the Spirit-filled life. That God's Spirit lives in us and will use us at the pregnancy center, at your high school, at your middle school, at your office. When we get dressed every day, make sure that you are putting on the Spirit of God, because that's where your power is. That's where your strength is. You know, I've got a great coat right here. It is a beautiful coat, wouldn't you say? Nice little handkerchief in it. Been wearing it all day. I'm ready to take it off. But let me show you what this coat can do. I mean, this coat is an unbelievable coat. All right, coat, right now, I want you to stand up for everyone to see you. Come on. Come on, stand up. Wave your arms around. Come on, coat. You did it earlier. You can do it now. Pick up this Bible. Preach a little bit. You say, Jack, that's silly. What are you trying to say? You see, this coat is empty. But when I put on this coat, put my arms in it, it can stand up straight, wave its arms around, pick up this Bible. That's what God was saying to Gideon, that he was to clothe himself with the Spirit of God. And God has called us to clothe ourselves with his Spirit every day, to put on, as the scripture says, the Lord Jesus Christ, and wear him and let him wear us like a suit. Well, the battle was engaged, and God gave the children of Israel a great victory against the Midianites. They had some unusual weapons. They had a trumpet, they had a pitcher, a clay pot, and a light within that clay pot. They broke the clay pot, they shone the light, they blew the trumpet. The Midianites were frightened. They turned on themselves. They were killing themselves. They were running away. The sword of the Lord and of Gideon, and God's people experienced a great victory. They had 100 over here, 100 over there, 100 over there. They're shouting their victory call, and the enemy was routed. Now, we've got a lot more than 300 people here tonight. We've got a couple of thousand people here tonight, 1,500 maybe. So five times more than they had. And on Sundays and weekends, of course, we have thousands of people who gather in this place. What I want to challenge you to be is Gideon's army, a mighty army. Can you imagine if God could do that with 300 so long ago, what he could do with us? If the Spirit of God was upon us, if the power of God, that if we had a courageous call and committed to the call of God upon our lives and the work of Jesus Christ, can you imagine these people that are coming here, the thousands and thousands of them that are moving into our community that need Jesus, they wouldn't stand a chance against the army of God. If we would move like a mighty army. Gideon was a nothing general leading a nobody army, and yet God gave them a great victory because it was for his glory. You know, it doesn't take much of a man or a woman to be a Christian, but it takes all the man, the woman there is of us. It doesn't take much of a church to be used of God, but it takes all the church that we have. I want to challenge you on these Wednesday evenings and going forward that you would be like Gideon's army. There's more than Gideon had. Maybe some are afraid, need to go home. I don't know. Maybe some are careless. But I pray that you would get your heart warm to the work of Jesus and the power of God in your life, and that we could move together like a mighty army. Amen? Amen. Amen. Let's stand together, all of us. I want us to sing our way out of here. I want us to worship as we close. I want to thank you for being here. You didn't know what to expect. I asked you to come. We asked you to come, and you did. Tell your friends about it. When we meet again in November, it's going to be better than this. I promise you. You know, that wasn't a great sermon. It's the best I had tonight, all right? But it's going to be better. The prayer was great. The worship has been awesome. We're going to share communion together, as I said. We're going to worship together. We're going to get on our knees. We're going to pray for the sick. We're going to do a lot of things. We'll hear great preaching. But like a mighty army, like Gideon's army, we're going to move. So let's sing together and bless the Lord. Thank you.
promise maker. Sing it with us. Promise keeper. You finish what you began. Yes, Lord. Our provision through the desert. You see it through.
Still we can know you are good.